Will you stand? All right. You've got 3 minutes to go say hi to at least three people. Ready to go? What's up, man? Appreciate that, bud. Thank you, man. Good morning. God is good. Amen. 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 I hope y'all are excited about hearing the word today, because we got a lot of chapters to get through today. We're going to at least get through 1 Samuel chapter 5, 1 Samuel chapter 6, and 1 Samuel chapter 7 today. It's going to be a blast, so hang on tight, because God's in control of all of it. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father, we're so thankful to be here to have the opportunity to read from your holy word. We thank you that we are righteous through Christ, and we thank you that you give us the opportunity. Your word says, be holy because you are holy, and so that's what we're to do. And we can only do that by having Jesus Christ in our lives, and the power of your Holy Spirit, Father, working in us. And so right now, I pray in the precious name and the blood of Yeshua, Jesus Christ, that I would not be seen nor heard, but Father, you would be seen and heard working through me. I pray, God, for every ear and every eye, both physically and spiritually, to be opened completely and fully to receive everything that you have for us today. I pray, Father, in the name of the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and Savior, I pray that the enemy would not have his way here, but in Jesus' name we rebuke him out. That there'd be no hindrance, that there'd be no heavy burdens. God, that we would trust in you to receive everything that we need today. I pray that every one of us would leave this building changed for your glory. I pray the same for our children that are learning across the hall, and all of the nursery workers and helpers and teachers that have sacrificed their time to teach our children. Bless and anoint their time as well. And I thank you that what we learn here today through faith will never be forgotten. May we be willing to apply it in our lives. In Jesus' name. In blood we pray. Everyone said in agreement? Amen. God is good. Amen. Give him a clap of praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Go to 1 Samuel chapter 5. I told you last week, glory to God, that as long as the Lord has us in 1 Samuel, we'll stay until he releases us to go elsewhere. But as for right now, we're moving on where we left off last week. 1 Samuel chapter 5, verse 1. If you've been with us over the past 4 weeks, we've come a long way from Hannah pleading to God for a baby. You remember? Raise your hand if you were here when we went over that about a month ago. Where in the world was everybody else? Yes. So you remember that, right? So we've come a long ways, glory to God, praise the Lord. Let's read it. 1 Samuel chapter 5, verse 1. If you remember in chapter 4, Eli and his two sons have died under the judgment hand of God. And so here we pick up 1 Samuel chapter 5, verse 1. If someone around you doesn't have a Bible, please share it, yours with them, and no one in your area has one, please look at the screens. And if you're here today and you do not own a Bible or you do not own a study Bible, one of the things we do is we hand those out for free. And we want to bless you with a good Bible today at no charge. So see me before you leave, and it'd be a blessing to put one in your hands. 1 Samuel chapter 5, verse 1, the Word of God says this, praise the Lord. When the Philistines captured the Ark of God, they brought it from Ebenezer to Ashdod. Then the Philistines took the Ark of God and brought it into the house of Dagon and set it up beside Dagon. And when the people of Ashdod rose early the next day, behold, Dagon had fallen face downward on the ground before the Ark of the Lord. So they took Dagon and put him back in his place. But when they rose early on the next morning, behold, Dagon had fallen face downward on the ground before the Ark of the Lord, and the head of Dagon and both his hands were lying cut off on the threshold. Only the trunk of Dagon was left to him. This is why the priest of Dagon and all who enter the house of Dagon do not tread on the threshold of Dagon in Ashdod to this day. Now stop right there. It's a lot going on in those first five verses of chapter 5. If you remember, the Israelites were defeated by the Philistines simply because the Israelites were living with rampant, terrible wickedness and sin in their lives. Probably 2 weeks ago, we talked about that, okay, how we can't expect to have a life of blessing when we're living a life that is struggling and embattled, embittered with sin, okay? And so now here we come to the point where chapter 4 has ended. The Philistines have taken the ark back home and into their chief city, if you will. And chapter 5 begins. The Philistines take the Ark of God and they place him beside their, what they considered was their greatest god, and his name is Dagon. In the Philistine mythology, Dagon was the principal god of the Philistines. How many people remembered the false god by the name of Baal? Raise your hand if you remember the Baal worshipers. Okay? Listen to this. Dagon was said to be Baal's father. And so if you've ever heard of Baal, then understand that that false god was created a daddy, and that false god is Dagon. And so here we have the chief false god of the Philistines, if you will. Something crazy about Dagon is that Dagon, this false god, had the torso of a man. Dagon had the head of a man. And Dagon was created by the people to have arms of the man. But when they created Dagon, they made the lower portion of him from the waist down as a fish. Now, I don't know about you, but that's the last thing that I'd want to be praying to. Amen? I mean, sounds pretty confused, doesn't it? Hey, but this is true, and we can prove this not only in Scripture, but we can also prove this with ancient writings and statues of such. By placing the Ark of God in the temple of Dagon, the Philistines were actually making fun of Almighty God, claiming that Dagon was stronger since the Philistines won the battle. And basically, to spit in the face of God, they take the Ark of God and they sit him beside Dagon in the temple of Dagon. But remember, friends, the reason the Israelites lost the battle to the Philistines was not God's fault. Whose fault was it, church? It was the Israelites, and it was the sin that they had in their lives. God dealt with the Philistines for placing the ark in the temple according to 1 Samuel chapter 5, 1 through 5. Okay? God deals with them. And we will see in a moment how he later places judgment on them. But as for Dagon, before we go any further in this chapter, let's understand what took place. As for Dagon, God, in the first five verses, knocked Dagon over, not once, but how often, church? Twice. And so God knocks Dagon over twice, and the second time, he breaks him into pieces. Now, obviously, God could have done that the first time if he wanted to, but he's teaching a lesson here. So the first time, the next morning, the Philistines come in to worship, and there's their false image, their false god is laid over, and they pick them back up. And they thought all would be well. Just by chance, Dagon has fallen over. And they come in the next day, and they look, and not only has he fallen over, but his parts and pieces have broken off. Let me tell you what God did. God caused Dagon to fall prostrate on the ground as though in worship towards him. Scripture said that when he fell, he was pointing in that direction. And basically what God is saying is, no matter what you have in your life,
that takes you away from me, you will see that no matter what, I will be honored here. And God took that false idol and he slain it over towards him. And then he dismembered him. And he was done with him. It was such a big deal that Scripture says to this day that the people who worshiped Dagon wouldn't even come onto the floor with him any longer. Look at chapter 5, verse 6. Look what happens next. The hand of the Lord was heavy against the people of Ashdod. I remember they've taken the Ark of God and they've taken it into this city. So the hand of the Lord was heavy against the people of Ashdod, verse 6, and he terrified and afflicted them with tumors, both Ashdod and its territory. Now, what happens is he ends up sending rats, mice into the cities. Scripture speaks of a plague. Scripture also speaks of certain things that took place, and when you put certain pieces together, depending on how you study it, most biblical scholars believe one of two things. One, that certain glands in their bodies broke out, but then also people teach it a little further because of the certain type of disease that the rats would carry. And they believe that not was it just any particular gland, but they believe that the people in all of these cities broke out in hemorrhoids. Now you talk about being sore. Imagine having hemorrhoids in a godly fashion of plague. God so punished these people that when he sent the plague to them, we're going to see in a moment in Scripture that they were begging God to remove the Ark of the Covenant. They didn't believe in God, and you've got to understand this, but we're getting ready to see in a moment that it says that they cried out to heaven. In other words, that for a brief moment, they were willing to acknowledge Dagon couldn't do what God could do, and all of the Philistines, it was so bad, it was so treacherous, the punishment and the judgment was so heavy upon the Philistines that Scripture says they actually cried out to heaven. And so for a moment, if they wouldn't confess Yahweh as creator, they did at least confess that Yahweh, God Almighty, was in control of the punishment. He was the only one that could get rid of it. And it said they cried out to heaven because of it. And maybe you know some people in your life like that. Maybe they don't follow Christ regular. But maybe when something bad happens, they have at least of enough common sense to know there's something out there greater in control other than themselves. Amen? And this is where we see the Philistines. They've got to be at this point because their false god Dagon has fallen over twice and now he's broken to pieces. Look at what it says in verse 7. 1 Samuel chapter 5, verse 7. And when the men of Ashdod saw how things were, they said, "The ark of the God of Israel must not remain with us, for his hand is hard against us and against Dagon, our God." Lowercase g. Verse 8. So they sent and gathered together all the lords of the Philistines and said, "What shall we do with the ark of the God of Israel?" They answered. Now notice lords is lowercase l there. They're talking about their leaders. We'll get to that in a moment. They answered, "Let the ark of the God of Israel be brought around to Gath." Now imagine if you live in Gath and you've heard of all that's happened in Ashdod, how many of you would be excited that this ark has now showed up in your neighborhood? Well, watch what happens in the middle of the 8th verse. So they brought the ark of God of Israel there, verse 9. But after they had brought it around, the hand of the Lord was against the city, causing a very great panic. And he, God, afflicted the men of the city, both young and old, so that the tumors broke out on them. So they sent the ark of God to Ekron. Now here we've had Ashdod. All right, here we've had Gath. And now we're going to send this ark of the covenant over. We're going to send the ark of God. We're going to send the ark of God over to Ekron, city number 3 of the Philistines. How many of you would be excited about that? After you've seen it, 2 for 2. He's batting 1,000, and now he's coming to your neighborhood. Verse 10. And so they sent the ark of God to Ekron, but as soon as the ark of God came to Ekron, the people of Ekron cried out. Now here, they done figured it out, see? It says the people of Ekron cried out, "They have brought around to us the ark of God to Israel to kill us and our people." And these are all Philistines here. In every city, these are major Philistine cities.
Verse 11. They sent therefore and gathered together all the lords, lowercase l. They sent together and gathered together all the lords of the Philistines and said, send away the ark of God of Israel and let it return to its what, church?
Own place.
Look at your neighbor and say, you can't change God. No. Look at somebody else. Say, you can't change God. Hey, listen, it doesn't matter how hard you try or how hard you want to. God is God. His word is his word. Truth is truth. And you ain't changing that. Neither am I. And so we quickly need to figure out either we're on board with God or we're not. The scripture says that light has no fellowship with darkness, nothing in common. And Jesus says, according to the text, he'd rather us be hot or cold, but he doesn't want us lukewarm. You know why he doesn't want us lukewarm? Because then we fooled ourselves and we'd allow Satan to fool ourselves into making us think that we can play both ways in the game and everything's okay. It's either one or the other. We're either for God or we're what? Or we're against God. And so here, yet again, God wins. He always has, is, and always will win. Amen? So look at what happens. Go back to the 11th verse. They sent therefore and gathered together all the lords of the Philistines and said, send away the ark of God of Israel and let it return to its own place that it may not kill us and our people. Now, this is heavy stuff here. For there was a deathly panic. Hear that. For there was a deathly panic throughout the whole city. The hand of God was what, church? Heavy there. The hand of God was heavy there. Verse 12, the men who did not die, hear this, the men who did not die were struck with tumors, and the cry of the city went up to where? Heaven. See, listen to this. There's five cities at this time in Scripture that we're reading about. The five cities of the Philistines were this: Ashdod, Gaza, Ashkelon, Gath, and Ekron. And each had a ruler, one ruler that they would call Lord, lowercase l. And so what happens is, as the ark of God goes around and these rats and plagues and tumors are coming forth onto the people in its land, and people are dying, and people are sickly, and people are fearful of their lives, they call upon the lords, their rulers. No one wanted the ark of God to remain in the city because of the rats and the tumors were coming upon the people and they were dying. Look at verse 11, please. 1 Samuel chapter 5, verse 11 says the following. The word of God says, for there was a deathly panic throughout the whole city. The hand of God was heavy there. It goes on in the 12th verse to say, pay attention. It says, the men who did not die, hear that, the men who did not die were struck with tumors, and the cry of the city went up to heaven. And here, at least for a moment, they're willing to acknowledge that God is in control of at least this. People were living in complete fear, according to the text. They wanted the ark of God to leave and to leave immediately. The God, hear this, the God that they thought they had defeated was now defeating them. And now they're coming face to face with reality. But look at what happens in chapter 6. The ark of the Lord, 1 Samuel 6:1. The ark of the Lord was in the country of the Philistines 7 months. And can you imagine that? 7 months of plague, 7 months of rats. Ladies, how many of you in here, ladies, when you just see one little mouse, you get terrified? Raise your hand at that, right? If it's in your home, you've got to have somebody just get that out. And I can remember sleeping early one morning, sun wasn't even thought about coming up good yet. Very dark outside. My wife was getting ready. She had to get up early and go to work. And I just heard from the kitchen a scream. In my sleep, before even, no joke. Have you ever been thinking before you open your eyes up? Right? You know it's a new day. You just hadn't opened your eyes up. I mean, I'm sleeping. I hear a scream, and immediately I knew, man, that scream does not sound good. She done seen a mouse. It don't belong in the home, according to her. It ain't supposed to be in her kitchen, of all places. And I know that I'm the one that's got to go handle business this early in the morning. Could you imagine having tens upon tens upon tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of rats everywhere in all these cities? Everywhere you go. I mean, it was a plague much like
what Pharaoh had to deal with as far as they're just everywhere. I mean, listen, they were so rampant that they were carrying diseases and the people were catching the diseases. That's how rampant this plague was with rats. And watch what happens here. Verse 1 again, because I don't want you to miss this. 1 Samuel chapter 6, verse 1. The ark of the Lord was in the country of the Philistines. How long? Do you want to know the only thing that kept that problem in their country? Starts with a P. Hey, there it is. Pride. Pride. Pride comes before the what? Hear this. The only reason that plague stayed in there for 7 months is because pride. They didn't want to admit that God had actually beat them. They didn't want to admit that God had beaten Dagon. They didn't want to admit that their God was false and made by hands of man. They didn't want to admit it. And because of it, people died. Men, women, children died in all of these cities because the leaders had too much pride. Sound familiar? Pride. Look at the next verse. 1 Samuel chapter 6, verse 2. And the Philistines called for the priest. All right, now here we go. And the Philistines called for the priest and the diviners and said, "What shall we do with the ark of the Lord? Tell us. With what shall we send it to its place?" In other words, they're saying, how are we going to get it there? We don't want to touch it. We don't want to carry it. I mean, these people have been struck with true fear. Verse 3, the priest and the diviners, they said, "If you send away the ark of the God of Israel, do not send it empty, but by all means return him a guilt offering, and then you will be healed, and it will be known to you why his hand does not turn away from you." And in verse 4, they said, "What is the guilt offering that we shall return to him?" And they answered, this is what you're going to give to God: 5 golden tumors and 5 golden mice, according to the number of the lords of the Philistines, for the same plague was on all of you and on your lords. So you must take images of your tumors and images of your mice that ravaged the land and give glory to the God of Israel. Hear that? Now there's coming a day, even in today's culture, there's coming a day where every knee shall bow and every tongue's go what? Confess that Jesus Christ is what? The Lord. Verse 5. Perhaps he will lighten, speaking of God here, perhaps he will lighten his hand from off you and your gods and your land. Verse 6. Why should you harden your hearts as the Egyptians and Pharaoh hardened their hearts? After he had dealt severely with them, did they not send the people away and they departed? Now then, take and prepare a new cart and 2 milk cows. Now listen to the plan here. Now then, take and prepare a new cart and 2 milk cows on which there has never come a yoke, and yoke the cows to the cart, but take their calves home away from them, and take the ark of the Lord and place it on the cart and put it in a box at its side, the figures of gold with which you are returning to him as a guilt offering. Then send it off and let it go its way. And then what's it say to do? Watch. Verse 9. And watch. If it goes up on the way to its own land, to Beth Shemesh, then it is he who has done us this great harm. But if not, then we shall know that it is not his hand that struck us. It happened to us by coincidence. There's a lot to talk about right here, so let's just get into it, amen? The events in the first 5 chapters, as we just talked about, took 7 months. And the people are ready to put an end to this situation with the Ark of God. However, listen to this. Still wanting to save face and not admit that God had won, the Philistine lords come up with a way to send the ark back to Israel without involving the Philistine people. Okay, so the priest and the diviners, the magicians of magical arts, they come in and say, "We've got a plan, and we understand no one wants us in their city anymore. We understand that no Philistines want to touch this or deal with this, and so we've got a plan." And this is what we're going to do. We're going to take two young cows that have just given birth, okay? And they've never had a yoke put around them to pull a cart. And we're going to have them go from here to all the way down there. And if they make it without going left or right, then it was God. But if they turn around to come back to their calves, or if they stop to eat, or if they take a left or a right, then it wasn't God at all. And we won't look foolish. See, in their plan, they left an open window of opportunity to still try to be better than God, didn't they? See, yet again, the Philistines we see are testing God by not placing a driver on the cart. Think about that. What if you went out to your car on the way home, and you put your wife in the back seat, and you started your truck, and you threw it in drive and got out the way and say, if you're of God, woman, he'll get you home. But if you're not a God-fearing woman, they have put the ark of God on a cart with two animals that have never been trained to pull a cart. And they say, if God's real, he'll get this cart to where it needs to go. How many of you know Scripture says, do not test God? If you're taking notes, jot this down. Jot this down. Number one, they took two cows that had calves and they separated them. That's the first big thing here, because any mother wants to turn around and go back to the calf. This is why Scripture says that when they went, they were lowing. Calling out, but they never broke left or right. They never turned back around. They just called out. That's number one. Number two, the cows they used had never driven a cart before. Jot that down. The cows they used had never driven a cart before. They'd never worn a yoke. Most guys in this room, you probably have what you call a funeral suit. Raise your hand if you know what I'm talking about, at least. Right? If you got a funeral suit. And you ever been a while before anyone had passed? Maybe you hadn't put that suit on in a while, and maybe it's been a few years, and you go to dust that old rascal off and put it on, and it just don't fit like it used to 12 years ago. Remember that? It shrunk. Either that or I've gained muscles. They've never worn it. You've got to imagine that most animals need to be broke. It's uncomfortable. What did you just put on me? I'm a mama that just gave birth, and I got a baby back there. And oh yeah, here's number three. Write this down if you're taking notes. She wanted to release her milk. She didn't want to take this long journey full of milk. How many of you, after you eat, fellas, you get up from the table and you want to go what? Take a nap. Go sit down. Just go take a load off. Kick your feet up. Throw your socks off, right? And watch your wife clean the kitchen. That's what you do, ain't it? Huh? Watch out. Don't get in trouble up in here. How many husbands lovingly volunteer to help your wives clean the kitchen? Look at that. Praise the Lord. We've got a few good men here. Imagine it. This is a female cow that needs to release her milk. At some point, she's going to come into pain and just wants it to be over. I've got to get this off me. And so that's number three. Let me tell you something else that they had set up against God, because all these things the Philistines are setting against God. Number four, this is the big one. From point A to point B, in other words, from the Philistines to where the Israelites were located, was 12 miles. Everybody say 12 miles. Now you go figure, if you put that pickup truck in drive and tow your wife, woman, if you're godly, you're going to get home, and you live 12 miles from here, I'll see you at the house. 12 miles
12 miles, and these cows for 12 miles couldn't go to the left, and they couldn't go to the right. That's another thing that the Philistines put in the face of God. They said, these cows better not go left or right for 12 miles, or you're not God. And maybe we've been there before, maybe not in that area of dramatics, but maybe we've said before selfishly and sinfully, God, if you're real, you'll do this. But God, if you really love me, you'll do this. But God, if you really care for my family, you'll do this. But God, if you really want me to have a job, you'll do this. And maybe in our own selfishness, it seems innocent, doesn't it? We're still not to put God to the test, ever. 12-mile journey. These two cows that were full of milk, babies back in the stalls, never worn a yoke, never pulled a cart, never been that way before, and yet now they've got to go. And let's see what God does, the Philistines say. The Philistines had set this up in hopes that they would win and not have to be humbled and humiliated. If the cows just stood there and didn't move, listen to this. If the cows just stood there and didn't move, the Philistines won. If the cows wandered to the left or right, of course, the Philistines won. If the cows turn around and immediately go back to their young, the Philistines won. The Philistine lords and their wise men thought that they had figured it all out. And watch what happens next in 1 Samuel chapter 6, verse 10. The men did so, and they took two milk cows and yoked them to the cart and shut up their calves at home. And they put the ark of the Lord on the cart and the box with the golden mice and the images of their tumors. And the cows went straight. They got to go 12 miles, remember. And the cows went straight in the direction of Beth Shemesh along one highway. Here it is, lowing as they went. They turned neither to the right nor to the left. And the lords of the Philistines went after them as far as the border of Beth Shemesh. Now, the people of Beth Shemesh were reaping their wheat harvest in the valley. And when they lifted up their eyes and the Israelites there see the ark, they rejoiced to see it. And the cart came into the field of Joshua of Beth Shemesh and stopped there. Isn't that something? The Philistines say go. The cows go. They go exactly where they need to be, and they stopped exactly where they needed to stop. A great stone was there, Scripture says, verse 14. A great stone was there, and they split up the wood of the cart and offered the cows as a burnt offering to the Lord. This is the Philistines doing this now. This is the Israelites doing this. Verse 15, and the Levites took down the ark of the Lord and the box that was beside it in which were the golden figures and set them upon the great stone. And the men of Beth Shemesh offered burnt offerings and sacrifices on that day to the Lord God. And when the five lords of the Philistines saw it, they returned that day to Ekron. So they've gone home whipped. Verse 17 says, these are the golden tumors that the Philistines returned as a guilt offering to the Lord, one for Ashdod, one for Gaza, one for Ashkelon, one for Gath, and one for Ekron. Verse 18, and the golden mice, according to the number of all the cities of the Philistines belonging to the five lords, both fortified cities and unwalled villages, the great stone beside which they set down the ark of the Lord is a witness to this day in the field of Joshua of Beth Shemesh. Now let's talk about this. A lot just took place right there. They've gone from point A to point B. Jot this down if you're taking notes. If let's get Isaiah 1 on the screen, if we can do that. Isaiah 1, 3. We're gonna read this out loud as soon as it pops up. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 3, because this is big time. How did two animals get all the way 12 miles where they needed to go? All right, on the count of three, read this out loud. Here we go, class. 1, 2, 3, go. Stop right there. The ox knows what? His owner. And the donkey knows what?
it's Master's crib. How many of you in this room, you better believe that God instructed those cows exactly where they needed to go. That was not by chance, folks. Read it out loud again. 1, 2, 3, go. Man, that verse is getting ready to come to pass yet again, because what happens is there's going to be some Israelites that end up dying because they go and they go to look into the Ark of the Covenant. How many people of you know that that just won't for anybody to up and do? And so in their excitement of having the Ark of God come back, and they're just whoa, look at this, and here we've got a box with golden mice, and here we've got a box with golden tumors. Regardless of what it looks like, it's still what? Gold, folks. It's still gold. I mean, just think about this. If you had a gold brick or you had a gold stick, would you care which one you got? So they don't care that it's in the shape of a tumor. They don't care that it's in the shape of a mouse. They can melt all that down. Amen? And now they're excited. Hey, we got gold up in here. Then someone makes a mistake and they open up the ark. Scripture says that men had to die for that. And it was a bunch of them. It was a bunch of them. Yet again, the hand of judgment falls. So Isaiah 1:3, the ox knows its owner, the donkey its master, master's crib. See, the Philistines didn't know the one living true God, but those cows did. Look at how much pride can get in the way of a man, where animals can be more obedient than a human being. Isn't that something? God says that if we don't give him praise, who can God make cry out? See, God can do whatever he wants to do. It's his house and it's his rules. Nature itself, the creation of God, proclaims and gives praise to its creator. Amen? It's amazing. Now look at what takes place next. We're going to move forward. 1 Samuel chapter 7, verse 3. I'm sorry, 1 Samuel chapter 6, 19. Don't let me skip too far. Here we go. Verse 19. And he struck some of the men of Beth Shemesh because they looked upon the ark of the Lord. He struck 70 men of them. 70. And the people mourned because the Lord had struck the people with a great blow. Depending on what translation you're reading right now, church, it's also going to say 70 and 50,000. If you're reading in your King James, it's going to mention the 50,000 number. That 50,000 is not at Beth Shemesh, because that was such a small place, it couldn't have held 50,000 people. So what they believe is when the ark continued to move, more people made the same idiotic mistake. And so here we've got a total of 50,000 plus have been killed throughout this tight course of time right here. And look at what it says, verse 20. Then the men of Beth Shemesh said, "Who is able to stand before the Lord, this holy God? And to whom shall he go up away from us?" So they sent messengers to the inhabitants of Kiriath-Jearim, saying, "The Philistines have returned the ark of the Lord. Come down and take it up to you." Whoa, we've got now the Israelites doing the same thing with the ark that the Philistines did, didn't we? Nobody wants it, because the judgment of God is with it. You say, "Pastor, what does all this Old Testament stuff have to do with me living today?" But don't Christians do the same thing today? I don't know how close I want to get to God, because God's got rules. I mean, I'm okay going with church just as long as that man up front screaming, "Don't tell me how I got to be." I'm okay with going to church every once in a while, maybe on a few major holidays, but God can't have my weekends. I mean, that's my day. Is it really? I recently seen a study that says by the time your life is over, if you live into your 80s, you will spend anywhere from 3 to 6 months total time at red lights in your life. Think about that. What are we really doing? How much are we really wasting? How much are we really seeing the main goal, the main objective, the main purpose? I mean, what takes place right here, they're actually begging for someone else to take what they had been wanting, what they had been so excited to see come down on those carts And look at what happens, chapter 7, verse 1. The men of Kiriath-Jearim came and took up the ark of the Lord and brought it to the house of Abinadab on the hill. And they consecrated his son Eliezer to have charge of the ark of the Lord. Verse 2, from the day that the ark was lodged at Kiriath-Jearim, a long time passed, some 20 years. And all the house of Israel lamented after the Lord. Some people died, church, because they looked inside the ark of God. They had chosen not to follow the rules that God had given them. The word lamented that is talked about in verse 2 of chapter 7, it's actually a good word. The word lamented right here actually indicates that a desire for God is now growing in the heart of Israel. How many of you have been on that road before? Let's bring this from Old Testament to New Testament. How many of you been on that road before where you had a close relationship with God? You ended up walking in sin, drifting away, because that's what sin does. It does a really fantastic job of getting in the way in us and our Father, doesn't it? But then we realize something happens, whether it be an instance or a situation, or whether it just be devastation, or whether it just be the voice of God calling us through the Spirit. How many of us in here have known, I'm not doing as good as what I once was. I got to be better. I know I've been there. And so now the Israelites are lamenting. God is stirring in their soul. And maybe you're here today. Maybe you've got a desire to be brought back into the fold of God. Maybe you've got a desire to have a pure relationship with the Heavenly Father again. Maybe you once had that, and maybe you've now walked off. No matter what your situation or circumstance is, understand this. God always desires and requires a close relationship with His children. I mean, think about it. How many mothers and fathers in this room want to have a great relationship with your children and with your grandchildren? Raise your hand. And why would God be any less? Now put yourself in that seat for a moment. Why would God be any less? After all, the only reason we're breathing is because the Father allowed it. The only reason we have what we have is because He provided it. But yet far too often, in even the culture of the church, we don't give Him what He's worthy of receiving. And if nothing else, that's just time. If nothing else, that's just time. Look at what happens in the third verse. 1 Samuel chapter 7, verse 3. Here comes our man Samuel. He's been silent in the past couple chapters, but look at what takes place here. And Samuel said to all the house of Israel, if you are returning to the Lord with how much, church? All right, now listen, if you're here today and you have a desire to walk with the Lord again, how much of your heart does it have to require? Because the only way you're no longer walking good with the Lord is because He no longer had all of your heart to begin with. And so unless you fix what took you away, you'll never get fixed. And so look at what Samuel says, verse 3. And Samuel said to all the house of Israel, if you are returning to the Lord with all your heart, then put away the foreign gods and the Ashtaroth from among you and direct your heart to the Lord and serve Him only, and He will deliver you out of the hand of the Philistines. And so the people of Israel put away the Baals and they put away the Ashtaroth and they served the Lord God only. Now hear this, church. Samuel basically said, if you're going to return to God with all your heart, you have to get rid of everything that you've been putting in front of God in your life. Now listen to that. If you and I are going to serve God with all of our heart, all right? If we're going to serve God with all of our heart, we've got to put away everything that's been keeping us from serving God with all of our heart. To not do that, we'd be fools, wouldn't we? We'd be fools. I don't know why, but when I pull up to intersections, if there's a screw or a nail at the stop sign, it sticks out like a sore thumb. Because how many of you have ever had a flat tire or had to go help your spouse with a flat tire before? It never comes at the convenient moment, does it? I've never been sitting around thinking, I just hope that my wife gets a blowout today on the interstate. Man, that'd be awesome, you know? Because I could get up and I could go down there, and with it raining, And cars just blowing past me, man, that'd be so great, you know, people laughing and honking. I mean, that would just be fantastic for my day to day, you know. And so yesterday, my family pull up at a stop sign and right there on Hull Street in Chesterfield, and there's probably about, I don't know, 30 or 40 screws, four-inch screws, rather, in the at the stop sign area. And my wife, she knows by now, if I open the door, I'm going out to get something out of the road. And so I get out, and I said, I'm going to get that so I don't run over it. I knew my mother-in-law was coming through there short after me, and I said, you know, I'm gonna do a favor to my father-in-law. He don't know it yet, but I did you a huge favor yesterday, bud. So I get out, I'm picking up all these screws. Well, traffic comes behind my car that's at the stop sign, and this guy's looking out, and as I get to like 30 or 40, I look and there's more. Well, I'm going to keep picking up because where there was more was where you had to turn out onto the street, right? And so this guy behind me, he gets out. He says, man, what are you doing out here? I said, man, look at all these. He's like, man, I'll keep those. Those are brand new. And somebody's box must have just fell off the truck. So there's two men out there picking up screws. We must have been picking up screws, I don't know, Elijah, 5-10 minutes. I mean, we're out there just picking up screws. They're getting tired of sitting in the vehicle. They're embarrassed because there's a line of traffic pulling up behind us now. But guess what? I'm saving their day. I'm saving their money. I'm saving their spouse sitting at home that would have had to come out in all that rain yesterday. But don't you know God does that? God saves our day, and sometimes it gets on our nerves, don't it? Because, see, we only want God to save our day with what we're looking for to save our day, right? Because we see it as saving our day. It's our day. But no, it's really not ours. Whose is it? And see, you didn't make no kind of day, did you? Imagine if you had the ability to make a day. Do you know how messed up that'd look? Right? Right? I don't know if there's a Jeffrey in here, but this is Jeffrey's day. I mean, there'd be no one in here that says, I'm signing up for that. I'm living in Jeffrey's day today. Nobody. It'd be so messed up. I've got enough issues of my own. I don't need everybody else's jumping up in your day with your issues. How many people in here got enough issues? And you don't need someone else's issues in your day. Good grief. It's like the Spirit was just revealing that, you know. It's like God goes to save our day, and because it's not convenient to us or what we thought it would look like when he saved it, we get upset about it, and then we say, well, I don't want to do all that. God calls me out of that sin? No, that's not saving my day. That's one of my better parts of the day. And we've allowed our flesh to be fooled to thinking that that's the better part of our day. Is it really the better part of your day? I mean, if it was so great, would you continue to have to go to it every time you felt void of not having it? What it really has is control over your day. Understand that? What it really has is control over your day. Someone says, well, I can handle my sin. Can you really? Because if you can handle it, you no longer have it. Can you handle it really? You see, we can't even really have a control of what runs through our minds, can we? I mean, we're told to keep our minds on things that are up. But how many of us have still had thoughts creep in that are not of the Lord? Right? And so this is why there's warfare raging. And so I'm getting those screws. This gentleman's getting those screws. And we must have picked up 100 or more, probably, screws out of the road. Traffic's blowing by. Woo, woo, woo. Rain just woo. But I knew that it was the right thing to do. And maybe there's some people in here that got to make that type of decision today. Maybe you feel like it'll be dangerous because it's going to sever some relationships with some people. Well, you can fix those later, but the only relationship that really matters is yours and the Father. That's it. The Scripture says that we should be reconciled to God. That's all that matters. See, because if we can be reconciled to God, then everything else will come into place, won't it? And what doesn't come into place never meant to be there anyway. You remember that game that you had with your toddlers? You would take the triangular block and try to put it in the triangular opening, and then there was a square block for the square opening. It's like trying to take that square and shove it through the triangle. If it ain't gonna fit, it just ain't gonna fit. And so maybe in reconciling with God, there's going to be some things that you will no longer be able to fit in your lifestyle because you're now born again, a new creature in Christ. Amen? So look at what Samuel says, chapter 7, verse 3. And Samuel said to all the house of Israel, if you're returning to the Lord with all your heart, then put away the foreign gods and the Ashtaroth from among you. And here it is, direct your heart to the Lord. And I'm going to pray for that in a moment. God, may our hearts be directed to you. But here's another big kicker. Not only are we called to direct our heart to the Lord, look at what the next thing says in verse 3. that we're to serve God only. And when we direct our hearts to the Lord and we serve God only, look at what verse 3 finishes with. God will deliver you. God will deliver you. And maybe there's some people in here that just need a new heart. Maybe they just need a healing to go forward, to take place in their lives. Maybe there's some people with hurt in their heart. Maybe there's some people with pain in their heart. Maybe there's some people with rejection in their heart. Maybe there's some people with hatred in there. Maybe there's some people carrying grudges. Maybe there's a husband and wife here that just needs to forgive one another and move forward. Matter of fact, there is. In the section all the way to my right, that's your left, there's a husband and a wife here. The Lord has showed me who it is. I'm not going to call you out because you haven't been coming here long enough, but I want to let you know that that God is willing to heal. God is willing to heal your marriage with one another, but he says that you've got to be willing to just let go and forget it. Whatever it is that you've got against your husband, you've got to let go and forget it. And if you're willing to talk about that, I'll be here as long as it takes today to pray with you. Matter of fact, let's pray now. I can't leave like this. Father, you showed me a husband and wife here today. They love each other. There's no doubt about that. Matter of fact, that's part of the issue. Really, that's why they're here today, is because they love each other. And it's a good love, it's a pure love, because they're not willing to give up on each other. And they're willing to fight for each other, and that's what it's all about. But yet, even in loving, even in fighting for what's right and for what's true, there's still an issue at hand that's eating this person up. So, Father, I pray that you would heal that marriage. God, I pray that you would restore it. I pray that you would make it like new again for your glory. And I pray in the name and the blood of Jesus Christ that it would have a testimony that would bring others into your kingdom. And so in the name and the blood of Jesus Christ, I rebuke any and every enemy that was trying to steal, kill, and destroy there. But that the old would be forgotten, the new would be accepted, and they would be in step with your spirit. In Jesus' name and blood, everybody said, amen. Amen. Samuel is basically saying, if you're going to return to God, get rid of everything that keeps you from God. The same thing with marriages, same thing with relationships. If you want it to be pure, get everything out that keeps it impure. Amen. We can't expect ourselves to get any better when we're always throwing bad in the mix. And so look at what takes place next. We're almost done. We're heading on the home stretch. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, 14. Write that down if you're taking notes. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, 14. God said, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their what? Land. Let's read that out loud. It's too good not to read. 1, 2, 3, go. If all right, keep that on the screen for just a moment, right? So God's given an if here, amen? Which means there's a potential for a benefit on an if, right? Have you ever told your children, if you do this, then we'll go here, right? If you do this, then we'll do that, all right? So look at what God says, no different than a father to his children. That's what it is. If my people who are called by my name, now Scripture in the New Testament tells us that everyone in this room has been called. Look at your neighbor and say, you've been called. That means everyone in here has got a purpose. Hear that. That means everyone in here has got a purpose, and that means that everyone in here, God has a plan for your life. Amen? Well, I'm glad 15 of y'all are excited about that. Amen? I mean, God's got a plan for you folks. Get up and get involved with it. If my people who are called by my name, now here's what we got to do. All right, because the answer to the if is at the bottom of the verse. Look at it in 14, in verse 14. God says that he'll draw near, all right, he'll hear, and he'll forgive. All right, so here's what the if is. If we humble ourselves. Everybody say humble.
Humble.
Pray. Seek the face of God. Here's the kicker. Turn from the wicked ways. See, you can't, that's good, you can pull that down, thank you. You can't expect to have a good heart if you're still living with wicked ways. You understand that? It's not going to happen. You continue to have a poison heart because you've got poison in your life, sin. And so we can't expect for God to heal our land. We can't expect for God Almighty to heal our lives and do a work in our marriage if we've got this sin running rampant. And God says we're to be humble, pray, seek, and turn. Jot those four down if you're taking notes. Humble, pray, seek, turn. Humble, pray, seek, turn. Humble, pray, seek, turn. I'm going to close with this passage of Scripture here. 1 Samuel chapter 7, verse 5. Then Samuel said, so he just tells them they got to get rid of everything and follow God with all their heart. Verse 5, then Samuel said, gather all Israel at Mizpah, and I will pray to the Lord for you. So they gathered at Mizpah, and they drew water and poured it out before the Lord, and they fasted on that day and said there, we have sinned against the Lord. Number one thing that the Israelites did correct, they admitted they had sinned. You hear me? They admitted that they were wrong. And so not just to the couple over here that's struggling, but to everyone in this room who's struggling. Maybe that's all that needs to take place, is to just look into the eyes of whoever you've got the wrong with and just say, I'm sorry, I was wrong and I accept that. Please forgive me. Maybe that's just it. And maybe you owe someone that. And maybe that's what they're longing for. And you don't even know it yet. But that's all it'll take to fix the hurt and the pain. And see, you've heard me say this a billion times. You cannot have it fixed until you acknowledge that it's broken first. And maybe some people are just running from brokenness because you don't want to take the time to fix it. How about accept what's broken and put it in the hands of God to fix? So look at what Samuel goes on to say. Then Samuel said, gather all Israel at Mizpah, and I will pray to the Lord for you. So they gathered at Mizpah and drew water and poured it out before the Lord. And they fasted on that day and said there, we have sinned against the Lord. And Samuel judged the people of Israel at Mizpah. Now when the Philistines heard that the people of Israel had gathered at Mizpah, the lords of the Philistines went up against Israel. And when the people of Israel heard of it, they were afraid of the Philistines. And can you imagine that? They've got the Ark of God back that had just been taken up there by two cows, and we've already talked about everything that had gone on, and yet they're fearful again. But yet we've been there. Let's apply this Old Testament to New Testament living. How many of us have seen the hand of God work in our life, only later on down the road can acknowledge that we've been fearful of something before? Isn't it something how in our flesh we operate in failure so many times? I mean, we serve Almighty God, and Scripture says, Even when we're not faithful, he still is. And they've seen the hand of God, and just days later, I mean, here they are fearful. Verse 7. Now when the Philistines heard that the people of Israel had gathered at Mizpah, the lords of the Philistines went up against Israel. And when the people of Israel heard of it, they were afraid of the Philistines. Verse 8. And the people of Israel said to Samuel, do not cease to cry out over the Lord our God for us, that he may save us from the hand of the Philistines. Let me just tell you something, because the Holy Spirit just spoke to me this. The Philistines had put fear in the hearts of Israel. The Israelites were fearful because of a past battle. Now, this is a word for someone in here. The Israelites were fearful because of a past battle. Don't allow a past event to cause you from living your life for the glory of God today. Hallelujah. Don't allow what happened to you in the past dictate how you're going to do today. You understand that? Because you serve a faithful God. You may have been unfaithful in the past, and that's what led you in your route of failure. But God is still faithful today. And if you're willing to line up in the faithfulness of God today, then you'll be in victory for the glory of God. Now, look at what, amen? And look at what happens, verse 9. Or let's go to verse 8. And the people of Israel said to Samuel, "Do not cease to cry out to the Lord our God for us, that he may save us from the hand of the Philistines." Verse 9. So Samuel took a nursing lamb and offered it as a whole burnt offering to the Lord. And Samuel cried out to the Lord for Israel, and the Lord answered him. Verse 10. As Samuel was offering up the burnt offering, the Philistines drew near to attack Israel. But the Lord God thundered with a mighty sound that day against the Philistines and threw them into confusion. And they were defeated before Israel. And the men of Israel went out from Mizpah and pursued the Philistines and struck them as far as below Beth Kar. And then verse 12, Samuel took a stone and he set it up between Mizpah and Shin and called its name Ebenezer. For he said, "Till now, the Lord has helped us." So the Philistines were subdued and did not, listen to this, the Philistines were subdued and did not again enter the territory of Israel. And the hand of the Lord God was against the Philistines all the days of Samuel. The cities that the Philistines had taken from Israel were what, church? Restored to who? Israel. From Ekron to Gath. Remember those cities earlier? And Israel delivered their territory from the hand of the Philistines. There was peace also between Israel and the Amorites. And watch this, verse 15, here we are at Samuel. Samuel judged Israel all the days of his life, and he went on a circuit year by year to Bethel, Gilgal, and Mizpah. And he judged Israel, all these places. Then he would return to Ramah, for his home was there. And there also he judged Israel, and he built there an altar to the Lord God. You know, something really cool just took place. Maybe you don't even know it, but I'd love to share it with you. We see Samuel in the text right now, but it's really beautiful when you understand who Samuel is and where he come from. You remember Hannah? If you weren't here 4 weeks ago, you need to get that DVD from that service. It's free. Take as many as you want. But do you remember Hannah? Hannah was the one that couldn't have children. And she was made fun of because of that. Remember? And for years and years and years, she was degraded. Because having children, and especially boys, was an honor. And then you remember she found herself after the feast. She gets up and she makes her way to the temple. And she's there praying. Between her and God, she's crying. It says there was grief on her face. Scripture said that she was so into praying that her mouth was moving, but no words came out. And the priest, Eli, at the time, remember Eli? He looks up and he sees her and he accuses her of being drunk because she's just mouthing and no sound. And she says, "No, no, 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 no. I'm not drunk. I'm just praying." So then Eli says, "Well, what you're asking for, may the Lord give to you." And she told God, she said, "God, if you'll give me a son, I'll give him back to you." And so when he was just a little tyke, as soon as he was weaned from his mother's breast, she takes him up to the temple and she tells Eli, she says, "You remember me? I'm that lady." "Yeah, I remember you." She says, "Well, here's the answer to my prayer, and I've got to fulfill my end of the call. He's yours." Later on, Eli told her, he says, "May you and your husband have many children." And they did. But what's really beautiful about all of that and Hannah's faithfulness, it mentions a place where Samuel settled up roots. And it says that when he went on circuit, he would go all over judging. But he would always come back to a certain town. You want to know where that town is that he always went back to live? It was home, where he was born, where his mama lived. Whew. You take the Old Testament and say, how can we apply this to today? Because when you're faithful to give God what's God's, God always brings back home what he says is yours. And every promise that God gives in the text, every promise that God gives can be yours if you stand on it in faith and you believe that God is speaking that word through your life. You believe that God is in control and we're not. Think about that. A mother who finally had what she couldn't have, when she received it, had to release it. You can imagine, there could have been moments of regret. Who knows? There could have been nights of pain and loneliness. She had had that baby, and now he was gone again. I'm sure she wondered, because they would go up yearly to visit. Remember, scripture says that she would make a little, it says little robe. The text actually says she made a little robe. How many of your mamas can put yourself in that place? Your one baby that you had, you no longer gotten. You're just making him a little priestly robe every year as he grows. And you make that journey with your husband. The text said they would make that journey once a year to go offer the sacrifice at the temple. And they would take that little robe, and that would be her gift. And that was her moment with him. But then at every moment came an ending, and she always had to leave. And she was faithful in her coming, and she was faithful in her what? She didn't cling. She didn't beg to God to get him back. She just let God do what God was going to do. And then in the moment when God raised Samuel up, Samuel was able to go back home. And it took years before that took place. But Hannah saw her prayers answered because of her faithfulness to rely on a faithful God. Let's stand and pray. Father, no word can describe you. We've got what we would consider some strong words in our vocabulary, but really nothing compares and comes close. But we thank you for who you are. We thank you that we can read all that we've been studying in the Old Testament the past month. And we can pull from it and we can apply the text to our lives today in the New Testament. So I pray for every person in here that's been standing on a promise. And the scripture says that though it tarry, wait for a moment. Be faithful in your waiting. Be faithful in your waiting. Be faithful in your waiting. I pray for every person right now that our hearts would be directed back to God. Just like Samuel said, your whole heart has to be directed back to God. Your whole heart. And so, Father, I pray in the name and the blood of Jesus Christ that if there's any one of us that have something in the way in our lives that's pushing us from drawing closer to you, that's keeping us from having a better life with our spouse, that's keeping us from being better with our children or at the workplace, whatever it is that's hindering us from being a better witness, whatever it is, I pray, Father, that you would reveal it to us and that we would receive the strength from you to get rid of it. And we'd allow you to get rid of it. If there's anyone in this room and you've never asked Jesus Christ to be the Lord and Savior of your soul, I welcome you right where you're at. Just raise your hand. I'm going to pray with you. I'm going to pray for you. If there's anyone in this room that's never asked Jesus to be in control of your life, let me tell you, it is the only way to the Father is through Jesus Christ. The only way into heaven is by having Jesus as Lord and Savior of our life, by accepting what he did on the cross. It's the only way. The only way. It's not about how good you are. It's not about what your title is. It's not about how much you have or how little you have. It's about having Jesus as the Redeemer of your soul. We have been bought. The price. And all we we have to do is freely receive them. Is anyone here today? They've walked the walk and they've strayed. I pray that today, in the name of the blood of Jesus, would be your day of renewal. That you would cry out to God in time with Him. And that you would ask Him to show you things like never before. That's my prayer for you. That those things that have hindered you would hinder you no longer. And what we've read today, you would live and walk in your own life, giving God all of your heart, removing everything else, all the idols, all the things that take our time away from the Father. It's got to go. In the precious name and the blood of Jesus Christ, we ask all these things. Everybody said together, amen and amen. God is good. Amen. God is good. Remember to invite someone back with you next week.